In his essay on liberty, philosopher John Stuart Mill discussed the importance of individuality. Mill saw the free development of individuality as one of the essential elements of human well-being. When we passively allow the world to run our life, we're reduced to mindless machines. Our human capacities are withered and starved. By not following our own natures, we're left with no nature to follow. In contrast, when we run our own life, we exercise and develop all our faculties, including our reasoning, our judgment, our self-control. For Mill, individuality brings humans nearer to the best thing they can be. He pointed out that no one's idea of excellence was to merely copy each other, and that the original insights that spring from individuality are a key driver in human innovation. Mill said it was absurd to live as if nothing had been learned about the world before we came into it, but we should feel free to critically assess the traditions and customs we're born into. We're not obliged to follow empty or outdated conventions that have failed to anticipate our modern insights. It's no justification to continue practices on the grounds they've always been done. Justification requires evidence of ongoing relevance. For these and other reasons, Mill recognized there was always a need for people to discover new truths and to inform us when old truths no longer hold. And that need rested on the preservation of individuality. For Mill, whatever suppressed individuality qualified as tyranny, whether it was done in the service of humans or supposed supernatural entities. Tyrannies often conceptualized as the unconcealed exercise of cruel, unreasonable, and arbitrary power and control. We picture tyrants openly using menace and intimidation to pull us into orbit around them, coercing us to submit to their ideas. But the people who subjugate us aren't always openly abusive. Some inspire our genuine loyalty, even love. Some come in the guise of a hero, a champion, a savior, someone who will rescue us, heal us, enlighten us, affirm us. We welcome them openly, unaware we're taking in a Trojan horse. As with the tyrant, we fall into orbit around them, submitting to their ideas. As with the tyrant, this subjugation does all the same harm, suppressing our individuality, stunting our development, stifling our human capacities, our reason, our judgment, our self-control, and, on the wider level, sabotaging human innovation and progress. It's this capacity to inspire wholehearted allegiance that makes subjugation by heroes the most complex to tackle. Believing them to be truly good, we become their dedicated defenders, their devotees, their disciples. We are led by them, moulded by them, often keen to draw others into subjugation with us, and suspicious and hostile towards individuals who decline. Obviously, to suggest all heroes are intrinsically harmful would be asinine. In his book, The Lucifer Effect, Understanding How Good People Turn Evil, psychologist Philip Zimbardo gives a range of examples of genuinely helpful heroes, from whistleblowers to shelterers of persecuted groups, from individuals who organize their lives around a humanitarian cause, to the everyday heroes of the moment who act decisively when called to service. Clearly, heroes exist across a spectrum from helpful to harmful, and the nature of the hero is a big factor in whether we'll find ourselves subjugated. But arguably the biggest determinant is the way we ourselves conceptualize heroes. When we view heroes realistically as fallible human beings with accessible qualities, ideas, and skills, we can appreciate them and learn from them without diminishing ourselves. So long as we maintain that practical perspective, any malignant heroes looking for a submissive disciple to dominate will be disappointed. The problem starts when we view heroes as something bigger, when we elevate them above us as something superior, infallible, magical, when we idealize them as something abstract, symbolic, pseudo-parental, then we turn them into fantasies, no longer subject to rational appraisal. We imbue their ideas with false authority. We imbue their actions with fake righteousness, and they gain a new disciple. We're especially susceptible to magical hero fantasies when we feel powerless. When we experience tyranny, we might dream of a champion swooping in and rescuing us, propelled by pure altruism. If individuals turn up who seem to fit that description, we're not always quick to question what we might be surrendering by accepting their services. With our guards lowered, we fail to notice we're just swapping one kind of subjugation for another. We can see suppressive hero relationships in religion, politics, business, therapy, the family. I want to explore some of the Faustian bargains we misguidedly enter into. In their paper, Changing the World and Changing the Self, Rothbaum and colleagues noted that submission to powerful leaders, groups, or gods allows us to feel we're joining in their power. In particular, they cite the vicarious control evident in religious phenomena, for example, when we speak of gaining strength through a god. Of course, vicarious power is only reflected power. The moon has no light of its own, it just reflects the sun's light. Without the sun, the moon would disappear. Basking passively in the light of others is not a means of acquiring our own. But some folks who bask in the light of magical heroes come to mistake it for their own. In Alexander Pope's An Essay on Criticism, he cautions us not to succumb to an inflated sense of our own abilities. A little learning is a dangerous thing. Drink deep, or taste not the Pierian spring, a metaphorical source of knowledge. There, shallow draughts intoxicate the brain, and drinking largely sobers us again. If we plot people's confidence against their knowledge, we sometimes find a premature peak of inflated self-assurance right at the start. Having gained a little learning, we overestimate our proficiency. When we submit uncritically to magical heroes, especially supposedly infallible divine ones, our conviction can swell to absolute certainty. Our magical hero becomes the standard of truth. Every truth that contradicts our hero becomes a lie. We show unshakable faith in what our heroes tell us, and little understanding of it. Magical heroes can keep us stuck at the height of cocky ignorance for decades. Many of us who fall into misguided discipleship around them go to our graves installed on that summit. For those of us who do start to realize there's something wrong, we face a humbling nosedive into doubt and despair. This nosedive will be familiar to many folks who've managed to let go of magical heroes. I experienced it myself in my teens when, having been indoctrinated into Christianity, I realized I was no longer persuaded by its claims. Having lived high in the clouds for years, I set out to find sound, honest justifications for my discipleship, reasons that could withstand any scrutiny. Instead, I discovered I was in a giant emotional protection racket. Many magical heroes run rackets, promising to protect individuals from some harm. This protection often turns out to be non-existent. The magical heroes of Christian scripture, a God character and a man claimed to be his son, were said to offer two kinds of protection. One was protection from a realm of eternal torture, a realm beyond death that couldn't be verified. The other protection was from hazards in this earthly life, disease, disaster, destitution. To get this second type of protection, disciples had to plead for help from the magical heroes by praying. This second type would conceivably be open to verification, except for the fact the outcome was completely down to chance. Disciples were told their prayers might or might not be accepted. We might or might not escape our abusive partner. Our child might or might not die of cancer. Comedian George Carlin famously said he stopped praying to God and started praying to the actor Joe Pesci. And he noticed the prayers he offered God and the ones he offered Joe Pesci were answered at about the same 50% rate. Chance, divine intervention, is indistinguishable from actual chance. An unverifiable realm of torture is indistinguishable from a scary story. And a protection racket that fails to demonstrate any protective function is indistinguishable from a pure extortion racket. When our magical heroes become the defining standard of truth and morality, all kinds of concepts get corrupted. Superficially, some of these corruptions might seem positive, but the effects are corrosive. My former magical Christian heroes were said to have executive power to forgive all our transgressions against everyone. But forgiveness has to come from the people we hurt. No one else can forgive us in their place. A mother might forgive her son's killer for her own pain and loss, but she can't offer vicarious forgiveness on her son's behalf. The idea of divine vicarious forgiveness destroys the concepts of moral agency and responsibility on which forgiveness rests. It means we're no longer answerable to the people we wrong. Their grievances with us can be erased by a third party. And the corruption goes deeper. To receive this worthless vicarious forgiveness, we're told we have to forgive others. We have to forget about any apologies. If we don't forgive them, our magical heroes won't forgive us. In this atmosphere of unearned forgiveness, many disciples predictably learn to take it for granted. In 2017, Amber De Bono and colleagues saw this reflected in three experiments where participants were led to believe they were unsupervised. Christians who were instructed to read and write about a forgiving God stole more money and cheated more on a math test than Christians who read and wrote about a punishing God, a forgiving human, a punishing human, or a neutral story. De Bono and colleagues remarked, "It seems that feeling that God has forgiven our own trespasses may merely leave us feeling free to trespass again." Obviously, to suggest all Christians would cheat or steal like that is absurd. Honest Christians wouldn't dream of it. But this finding will resonate with many Christians and ex-Christians who've been repeatedly mistreated by fellow disciples who never apologize or mend their ways. Because every week at church, there's an enforced amnesty where everyone has to forgive everyone else or suffer the consequences. Automatic forgiveness is not the loving concept it might seem on first glance. It stunts our moral and social development. For abusive disciples, it removes the incentive to reflect on their behavior, to take responsibility and do better. For targeted disciples, it breeds resentment, which they're expected to just go on swallowing to bursting point. Forgiveness gained by proxy or inducement is worthless emotional snake oil. When we use these magical divine heroes as role models, taking everything they say and do to be correct, we reproduce their chaos, their virtues, their flaws, their wisdom, their stupidity, their charity, their abuse. We mimic the good and the bad without comprehending the difference. We can also find ourselves mimicking behavior that has no moral component. Within the mystical branch of Islam known as Sufism, there's a story of a disciple called Bayezid Bastami who refused to eat watermelon because he didn't know how Islam's author, the magical hero Muhammad, cut and ate watermelons, and he didn't want to do it the wrong way. There are similar stories in Islam of a disciple who would do a 360-degree turn on his camel after mounting it, and a disciple who would kiss stones for no other reason than that they'd observe their magical hero doing it. Replicating arbitrary gestures is the foundation of superstition. As humankind proceeds into uncharted areas, the gulf between our long-dead magical heroes and our modern lives becomes ever wider. Advancements in technology and medicine, from in vitro fertilization to interplanetary colonization, raise new kinds of moral questions for which our magical heroes' dusty old scriptures offer no explicit guidance. Would colonizing other planets be a crime in the eyes of an Abrahamic God character? Maybe taking what was meant for other life forms? Without scriptural direction, we're left with limited options. We could approach these issues like Bastami's watermelon and refuse to participate in any unmentioned activity. Or we could try to find scriptural approximations and make guesses. The governing body of the Jehovah's Witnesses forbid blood transfusions based on biblical passages that forbid the eating of blood, which has nothing to do with transfusions. Or we can take the try and see what happens approach employed by the same JW governing body in regard to genetically modified food. In an April 2000 article in its magazine Awake, it couldn't decide whether or not this biotechnology was equivalent to playing God. The article concluded that if it was playing God, the magical divine hero could step in and reverse this development. But what if he doesn't step in? Does that mean he approves? Or what if he's just silently observing and condemning everyone associated with genetically modified food for daring to play God? These immobilizing questions bring home the central plight of the disciple. We can't move past our magical heroes. We're confined to their limitations. In order to move forward, we have to dethrone them and their bogus literature. Pluck any novel from a shelf and odds are we'll find some wisdom, some insight. Even cookery books often digress from recipes into some half-baked personal philosophy from the author. It would actually be hard to write a book totally devoid of merit, even if we consciously tried. But just because a book's got some good ideas, we don't abandon all judgment and slavishly follow every word. Even when books are marketed as a guide to life, we still decide what parts we find useful, if any. Not so when we assign magical status to the author. Part of life development is about separating things we've mistakenly blurred together, like nudity and sex. Blood relatedness and a sense of obligation. Often we blur ideas and people. We need to separate them. Good ideas can come from any source. Even tyrants occasionally express worthwhile thoughts. I often start my videos with a quote. Over the years, people have criticized some of the authors, citing some past transgression, minor or major. They've criticized me for appealing to dubious authorities, but I'm not appealing to authority. The quotes are about the idea, not the author. The author is incidental. Often, many people will have converged on the same thought. Sometimes I'll have significant disagreements with the author. The source doesn't validate or negate the idea. The idea stands or falls on its own terms. If authors have failed to uphold their own stated values, we get an entertaining smack of irony. Letting go of our magical heroes, divine or human, is often just about separating ideas from people. Amazing how the world changes when that simple surgical act is performed. Descending from the certainty of divine discipleship can feel like crashing after long-term dependence on a euphoric drug. One that's often been injected into us from infancy. In the throes of cold turkey, we're not always ready to see the upside, which is that moving past the magical hero clears the path to knowledge. With a bit of rigor and discernment, we can build sound foundations, enjoy more justified confidence, and generate our own light instead of basking in the false light of magical heroes. Magical heroes aren't exclusive to religion. We might look for them in family, friends, teachers, partners, celebrities, politicians. If we're lucky, the people we try to cast as our magical heroes will decline that role. They'll reject our unreal expectations and weather our disappointment. Every rejection of our magical fantasies is an opportunity to give up our passive one-down position and fully embrace active, independent development. If we're not so lucky, the people we grant magical status will accept that status. When two parties start feeding off each other in a mutually gratifying one-up, one-down fantasy, that's a tough bond to break. Rational appeals are often useless. If our respect and curiosity for truth is powerful enough, we might be willing to listen to reason. But if we're more invested in comfort than truth, something a surprising number of people cheerfully admit to, we'll dismiss the most reasonable voices as misguided or even malicious. Generally speaking, escaping a magical hero fantasy means a prison break from the inside. Outside help might be offered, but we have to want to escape our false heroes ourselves. Bruce has felt downtrodden his entire life. It started with being beaten at home. Later, he was bullied at school. In his teens, he's befriended by a man in a bar. They talk about life and get to reflecting on their grievances. The man tells Bruce his binary philosophy. In life, you're either predator or prey. You have to choose which one you are. Bruce continues to meet up with his new friend, who introduces him to a like-minded network, offering him a replacement family and a sense of belonging he's never experienced. Over time, he's plied with books and videos, targeting a specific social group as the enemy, the reason the world is wrong. Bruce's anger is constantly stoked. He's encouraged to dwell on the times he's felt downtrodden and challenged to do something about it. Like a projectile, he's filled with ideological fuel and fired into society. The power he feels in trampling others down is intoxicating. Bruce is the predator now, and on a righteous mission. His brutality escalates as he reaches for more intense highs from the violence and greater recognition from his new family. Eventually, Bruce begins to recruit new members. Just like his recruiter, he won't care what happens to these individuals. He's even stopped caring if he survives himself. Destroying the enemy is all that matters. Bedelia has been a human punch bag in her abusive family. The only person who treated her like a human was her Uncle Tim. At family events, he always acknowledged her, while other relatives demeaned and dismissed her. In her teens, when she was involved in a car crash, Tim was the only member of the family to visit her. Just a fleeting visit, barely a minute long. But to Bedelia, it catapulted him to magical hero status. In her 30s, Bedelia finally confides in Tim about her abuse by the family. He's appalled, but not by them. He dismisses Bedelia as a selfish child and says he's changed his whole opinion of her. Betraying her confidence, he informs Bedelia's family of her allegations and empathizes with their apparent bewilderment and anguish. For days, Bedelia is consumed by doubt and self-recrimination, wondering how she can redeem herself in Tim's eyes. To the starving individual, a crumb is a feast. To an abused individual, a scrap of attention can feel like a tidal wave of love. In this distorted headspace, heroes are easily made from the thinnest material. For Bruce, a random sense of belonging was enough to cloud the fact his replacement family were happy to destroy him for their cause. For Bedelia, Tim seemed like a shining star, but only relative to the excessive darkness of the rest of her family. In reality, he actually paid her very little attention. There was no special connection. Tim was no hero. In these real-life cases, both Bruce and Bedelia came to realize they were looking for family in the wrong places. Fortunately, they would both find other people who lived up to the word family, who showed concern for their welfare and a willingness to walk alongside them even in the most difficult places. Recovery wasn't easy. Bruce had to face crushing waves of guilt for the violence he'd inflicted and work through some powerful suicidal urges. Bedelia was shunned by her entire family, including Tim. But the presence of authentic love in their lives showed them how deprived they'd previously been and expelled any fantasies of sliding back. Targets of abuse are often starved of examples of healthy, supportive people. But starving individuals must still learn to avoid poisonous food. Indigo engages Paul as her therapist. She sees Paul as someone who's figured life out. Her goal is to learn his magical insights and apply them to her own life. Although Paul tells her from the outset, is not there to offer advice, Indigo continues to ask for it. And, despite his intentions, Paul finds himself giving it. Their exchanges quickly fall into a pattern. Indigo describes some problem and insists she has no idea what to do. Paul tries to spark her thinking with some suggestions. Instead of thinking, Indigo treats Paul's suggestions as wise instructions, which she resolves to carry out. As the weeks go by, Paul finds himself constantly exhausted after their sessions, having done all the thinking. Meanwhile, Indigo, having done no thinking, has come to feel completely dependent on Paul. Paul is a reluctant hero. At the start, he fully intended to build a strong therapeutic alliance with Indigo, working together to address her problems. But he failed to pick up on her powerful expectations of him. He took her to be more independent and self-sufficient than she was. Until he tackles her expectations and allows her to experience healthy disappointment in him, he'll remain glued to a throne he never wanted. This real-life case illustrates how we can be pushed unwillingly into a hero fantasy by others. Livia signs up for a course run by a self-styled self-improvement guru who offers participants enlightenment, fulfillment, and joy. She attends 3 weeks of exhausting 10-hour training days, which, she's led to believe, will give her valuable self-insight. She's told not to criticize the guru or reveal any course content to outsiders and given pseudo-philosophical justifications for both these rules. She's constantly fed claims about the course's benefits and repeatedly urged to sign up for further courses and get friends and family to do the same. The sessions are sprinkled with pseudo-content, a mix of bumper sticker truisms and impenetrable esoterica. Livia ends the 3 weeks none the wiser and thousands of dollars poorer. Future courses will repeat this pattern, bombarding participants with endless procedure, jargon, and self-promotion. As Livia descends into serious debt, the single lesson she absorbs is buy more courses. When we invest in self-improvement, like therapy or formal teaching, we sometimes expect the thinking to be done for us. We adopt a consumer mindset. We've paid money, so we expect a product. In fact, our own thinking is the product. Therapists, teachers, coaches are only there to facilitate our thinking, and for an effective outcome, we need some idea of what we want to achieve, what specific areas we want to address, what specific changes we hope to see. Problems happen when we take a passive position, when we formulate no goals, or goals too vague to quantify. It's like telling a cab driver, "Oh, just take me somewhere." Our goals might even be magical, like perpetual happiness, freedom from self-doubt. This is like telling the driver, "Take me to Nirvana." Ethical drivers will decline our fare. Magical hero drivers will happily take us for a ride. Lena doesn't relate to the vast majority of politicians, their backgrounds, social circles, lifestyles. She longs to see someone like herself in power, a maverick, a rebel. In the elections, she votes for Bina, who markets herself as a woman of the people. Spina has no political experience and no special education or training in any identifiable field, but she speaks her mind and doesn't bow to anyone. She won't be told what to do. To Lena's joy, Spina wins the election. Once in office, Spina begins dismantling the institutions that restrain her. She ends long-standing treaties with other countries. She abrogates the rights of social groups she doesn't like. She disbands oversight committees and anti-corruption departments. In violation of her office, she exploits her position for personal gain through private businesses. In further violation, she initiates military force to neutralize peaceful protesters. Staff who advise against her reckless actions are dismissed. She won't be told what to do. When Lena's friends condemn Bina's unprecedented abuse of power, Lena is genuinely baffled. To her, Bina is a magical hero who's shaking things up. A maverick, a rebel. Just like Lena. She must be good. Sometimes we see some reflection of ourselves in a magical hero. Sometimes it's just a single trait, one we strongly identify with. It then becomes easy to project all our other qualities onto them. We create a vicarious fantasy that's hard to separate ourselves from. Their success becomes our success, and we make the same excuses and rationalizations for their failures and abuses that we'd make for our own. For John Stuart Mill, there were very few conceivable justifications for the existence of any governing power. One of them was to protect the freedoms of the people it governed. Not the freedoms of some, but the freedoms of all. Government was a form of practical service, and the power it wielded meant it needed to be held to the highest standards of accountability to guard against corruption. But when we view our leaders as magical heroes, we often hold them to the lowest standards of accountability because we've built our dreams on them. We ignore their corruption or excuse it as a necessary evil, in contrast to the unnecessary evil of other people's leaders. Magical heroes come in many forms. Family, teachers, leaders, gods. When we stop looking to them to fulfill our dreams for us and take an active role in achieving them ourselves, the impulse to defend their corruption fades, and we can acknowledge fraud, incompetence, and negligence wherever we see it. It's worth mentioning one last kind of discipleship many of us fall into. One where there's no tangible hero, but a system of rewards that draws us in, disrupts our thinking, stifles our development, and consumes substantial volumes of our lives. As far back as 1950, mathematician Norbert Wiener was reflecting on the idea of machines that could collect information about human beings to determine the most probable development of a situation. He noted how such machines could be used by other humans to increase their control over the human race. But he concluded this technology was unlikely to be realized, because with humans being so complex, the volume of data required would be impossibly vast. Fast forward to 2017, where, in an interview with Axios' Mike Allen, Sean Parker, former Facebook president, reflects on the challenge he and his fellow Facebook leaders once set themselves. How could they consume as much of our time and conscious attention as possible? They decided they could give users a little dopamine hit every once in a while because someone liked or commented on a post. They constructed a social validation feedback loop with users responding to their responders and so on, back and forth. Parker said this was exactly the kind of thing a hacker like himself would come up with because it exploited a vulnerability in human psychology. He said the inventors and creators consciously understood what they were doing and did it anyway. Constantly having our attention disrupted isn't great. Aside from fragmenting our thinking, the intermittent nature of these dopamine hits can make them extremely addictive. The user is kept in a state of uncertain anticipation, waiting for a hit that may or may not come. Some creators agonize over what kind of post will get a bigger response. Social media companies offer them endless tips to maximize audience engagement. Following these formulaic tips, creators can slowly lose their own voice and become generic photocopies. But these are just the upfront methods of molding us. The larger threat to individuality comes from the more insidious data-gathering side. Every time we respond to a notification, information is gathered about what kinds of material engage us. Platform software constructs an ever more complex picture of us and discovers how to extract more attention from us. Our addiction is constantly tweaked by a drug that's constantly learning how to increase our habit. We become a slave to the algorithm. Computer scientist Jaron Lanier cautions social media users about the relentless, robotic, ultimately meaningless behavior modification they're subjected to in the service of uncaring algorithms. Algorithms programmed to target us not with good or reliable information, but simply with what most reliably grabs us. Unfortunately, sensationalistic misinformation is often far more successful at that. Our online feeds and recommendations can quickly funnel us into echo chambers in which unqualified opinion is magnified over facts, with little exposure to differing viewpoints. Much like Bruce's case, many people have spoken about how either they or their friends or family became radicalized into some ideology by being drawn down a rabbit hole of recommendations. When this happens on a global scale, it can lead to unprecedented levels of tribalism. When we encounter disagreement, we think, how can they be so unaware? And they think exactly the same about us. We can avoid becoming echo chamber drones by exposing ourselves to a wide variety of sources, including sources that conflict with our own. With first-hand information, we can form our own judgment instead of relying exclusively on second-hand opinion. We can switch off notifications, either selectively or completely. Instead of fitting into their chaotic schedule, we can make them fit into ours, and experience the wonderful freedom and clarity of uninterrupted thought. The idiom, fire is a good servant but a bad master, applies to many things in life, including social media. In its place, it can educate, break down barriers, and unite people. When it's allowed to run wild, it can miseducate, build barriers, and divide people. Keeping it in its place is the challenge for all of us. We often submit to false heroes in the most desperate times, precisely because they seem to offer some escape, which is why it's during those times that we should be most vigilant when heroic figures appear offering salvation. Before accepting their services, we need to think carefully about what we might be surrendering. If the gift horse we're being offered is a Trojan one, we'll be glad we looked it in the mouth. Submitting to magical heroes might sometimes elevate us emotionally, but it diminishes us developmentally. As Rothbaum and colleagues point out, it can lead to a self-perpetuating cycle of greater dependence, increased fear of powerlessness, increased conformity, even greater dependence, and so on. Submitting to tyrants or heroes can have the same damaging effects. To achieve individual freedom, we can be no one's slave and no one's disciple.